is where I'm going to give you some background. Dr. Jones has been blogging for the last 3 years. See, a lot of the church, I'm not saying you guys, but a lot of the church world has a futurist view of Revelation. You know, where it's, everything's in the future. Where these guys, and I'm starting to see it's true, because I am no theologian. This stuff is really heavy. But these guys have shown through history and through current events that most of Revelation is over with. And we are coming to a glorious conclusion really soon. So Mystery Babylon is the antithesis, the opposite of the kingdom. We walk in love, they walk in hate. They walk in fear. You know, and they walk in control and manipulation and greed and secrecy and all this stuff. Oh, by the way, geez, that's a lot of the church now. Come to think of it, not this church. But how many know? Church has been feeding out fear and feeding out manipulating people's gifts and trying to build their own kingdom. That's Mystery Babylon, the harlot. It's not just the Catholic Church. That spirit's in most denominations. But there's a remnant that God is pulling out of the harlots. It's mystery because it's hidden. It's not literal Babylon. It's mystery. It's shrouded. It's infiltrated politics and science and religion. But I'm telling you that it's coming down as we speak right now. We're about to step into the most glorious move of God this world has ever seen. I am telling you, you think this is... If you're freaked out about this, you might as well just go to sleep for 1,000 years and miss the party. Because you won't be able to handle it. So Jones starts blogging, and he's got an anointing. He's very heady, but you know what? That is not a bad thing. You know, we're so... feeling and worship and, you know, supernatural, that we get around some of the other guys that we don't have that paradigm of, oh, he's in his head. But let me tell you something. Love the Lord thy God with all thy soul, mind. What do you think? We're more spiritual because we're ignorant? I mean, that's stupidity. But a lot of Pentecostals growing up, they were against, I don't remember that in some of the backgrounds. They didn't want to do education. That was that whole deal. No. No, God can blow on a nuclear physicist and give him an anointing to share the gospel in that nuclear physicist language to the other nuclear physicists. In fact, that's what's going on. God has given me an audience with these guys that are quantum physicists, mathematicians, historians, I mean, brainiacs. And what are they going to do? They're going to go reach the brainiacs. I can only go so far in that field. Larry, I'm back and I'm gold teeth. Hey, bravo, Shea Cafe. Listen, we have to get out of our comfort zone. We got to get out of a little myopic view of the kingdom. The kingdom is vast. God's people are multicultured, multicolored, multiracial, multi-everything. It's like God showed me a picture of the stone kingdom, and he's got his people scattered all around the mountain, walking up from every different side of the mountain. That's all going to culminate to Jesus. Oh, oh, now, oh. Let me share something. If you've been bucking a family member, if you've been beaten, ask God for more love. You know, I've had, because I've tried to sometimes cram truth and stuff. And really, by the way, that was never my heart. It was more just working stuff out. Never my heart. But my brother, let me tell you a story. Going back, okay, previous to the glory of God coming in my room, about a month or two before that, I was at a Robert Slaird convention in Chicago in 1992. I may have heard of him. Yeah. Wonderful, powerful young man of God. He fell into sin. I pray he's back. I don't know. But God used that. He was a young guy. He started in the ministry. He was about 17. I think he was about 29 or 30 when I saw him. Now, I want to give you some wisdom here because I'm just learning it myself. My brother's raised in the same household as me, but he never accepted the Lord, never had an encounter with the Lord. Right? We'd go to church, right? Get me out of here, let me go do whatever I got to do. Never had an encounter with the Lord. Didn't have any encounters like I did. And so I invited him to go up to this conference in Chicago, which is July of 1992. He's like, well, we're close. We love each other. We're blood brothers, and really, we're buddies. He's like, yeah, I'll go hang out with my brother. He's going to some conference. He's really saying to himself, yeah, I'll go get a few drinks. I'll get some Chicago pizza. And yeah, I'll go sit in the conference, whatever. He's not looking to get saved. He's not looking to repent.
He's not pressing in.
He's not pressing in. Oh, by the way, Saul, did he press in? Oh, the great apostle wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Wasn't he going to a church meeting, went up to an altar call? Is that how it happened? I forget. I'm sorry. All scripture. He goes on to say in Timothy that he is a pattern of long suffering to them who are going on to believe. What's the pattern? He had nothing to do with it. That's the pattern. That's how he's able to write, by grace you are saved through faith. It is not of yourselves. You know, for years, I never quoted that verse right. The traditions of men were in me so deep, I quote it this way. By grace you are saved through faith. It is a gift of God. It's not by works, as any man should boast. And somehow, cleverly, I was blinded to the not of yourselves part. And all of a sudden, I just jumped off the page. How could Paul write that? Because that was his, who used the fancy word, paradigm? Brother Larry. That was his paradigm. He knew he had nothing to do with it. So all the letters, you see, grace and peace, grace and peace, grace and peace, grace and peace. What else could he say? I'm the chief of sinners. I don't know how the heck I got into this thing. What the Dutch?
Where the heck are we?
Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Think a little bit of this test. As I'm sharing this word tonight, I'm going to ask you a question. Is faith arising in your heart? And is hope arising in your heart? See, when you preach, see, here's the thing. And I'm guilty of this, but it's okay because that's where God had me. Like the woman of the issue of blood. And I believe that. When I'm in the Philippines with you, when I just prophesy again, who knows? I'm going to say, you got to come up like the woman. You're desperate enough, you got to come. I'm going to preach that in those audiences. They need to hear, repent and come to Jesus. How many people have already repented and come to Jesus? Well, maybe it's time for some more meat. I know this man serves up a good steak. He serves some meat. Here's some more meat. We're having a buffet tonight. See, it's all about being the vessel of God at the appointed hour with the appointed words and the appointed people. That's what this is about. When I go to Dr. Jones and OJ, I ain't touching that. What? No. I'm going to go, ho! And hope God just shows up. And he does every time, and it's awesome. But now, there's been a cross-pollination going on that God's been doing, and I've been passionate and burning to bring this message to the body of Christ. And I know you've heard a lot about the sovereignty, but what's blown me away is this supernatural unveiling. It's been tripped. Let me tell you another testimony. Oh, wait, no, let me go back to my brother. Thank you, Jesus. So at that time, we're in Chicago. Now, I'm seeking God. So my paradigm is I'm pressing in. Okay?
Right.
He's going to party. His paradigm is, I don't give a flip. You see now, you got the mountain here. I'm coming up this side. He doesn't even know he's coming up a mountain. He's like, oh, what the heck's going on here? Okay, do. All right? And the glory of God, nobody touched us. The glory of God, I'm talking about, brother, you know it. Larry, you guys, some of you know it. That thick, sort of thick, hot, molten lava. Like one of those heavy lead, like those dentist vests, heavy, thick, and gooey, and whoa, you know, and you're melting out of the chair. And my brother, this is my brother. He goes from this, you know. What? You're Dutch? He's snotting. He's shaking. I'm sliding out of my chair. I'm like in this thick, invisible lava. I'm like, I feel like Gumby. In my religious brain, religiosity is just so stupid. I mean, it's insane. Robert Slade gives an altar call as if I didn't have enough what was going on. As if somehow I needed... Exactly. I somehow needed a man to lay hands on me. I only got the King of Glory, like, just sitting on me. And me and my retarded religious thinking, I'm literally on all fours, barely crawling like I'm through mud and quicksand. As I'm crawling to the altar, I must be the man of God. Lay hands on me. It was nuts. I have been completely whacked since July of 92. I'm telling you, it's getting better. See, what I love about what Bill Johnson says, you all have a testimony. If you just get aside yourself and just start sharing your testimony, that's where the life is.
That's right.
This
that's
is really
right.
just a testimony. I'm not exegeting the word and all that stuff. I'm just sharing my testimony. That's where the life is. The world wants to see Jesus and hear your testimony.
Yeah.
It's simple. We make this thing so hard. You want to hear? Wait, this gets so much better. This is crazy. I'm kind of hidden, but it's all going to come together. Anyway, so my brother's paradox, for years we have bucked heads. Because he parked himself in a Calvinistic church. This guy's a double PhD, and he honors all the academia, and he wants to get into the Word. But see, that was his journey. And he's fighting me. Oh, you're at a Word of Faith church for a year and a half. Oh, you're one of those prophetic churches. Oh, I see. And now you're over here in the charismatic circus. But he's a student of the Word. See? But finally, after 17 years, whatever the long was, yeah, stop that. Because we were really tight for about 2-3 years after that. And then I know what happened. I got married. And he got offended. That's a whole other story. But here's the point. We've been fighting over each other's paradigm. It's the sovereign grace of God. I pressed in. But here's the revelation God has given me. Yeah. Did I press in at the age of 2? No. Did I really press in enough to get a deluge of glory? No. And now with the dream and the signs, which I'm going to share some more with, it's pretty neat. So anyway, 999, by the way, in the Gematria in Hebrew is in the beginning God. In the beginning God. He's taking us full circle. From him and through him and to him are all things. He's flashing in the beginning because he's going to end up just like we started.
Yes. Yes.
This is the meaning of 999. Yes. But it doesn't end there. Right after the 999s, and this will answer your question, hopefully. And I might have all the answers, but it's okay because I know God's talking. See, when we're waiting, what this does is it gives me so much hope in the wait. Yeah. I know I'm not waiting in vain. Now, when you take that by faith, which we've done for years, I'm just trusting God. I believe God is God. And that's wonderful. I've done that. But God in his infinite mercy and grace is now showing me all this stuff. It's like every day feels like Christmas and Revelation. It doesn't matter that I'm waiting. God's just talking and showing me stuff. Who cares? So now after the 999s, this is trippy. I get 1111s and 111s. Now, it wasn't a dream. It was like every time I look at the clock, it was either 1111 or 111. It was bizarre, though. I wasn't looking for it. I'm telling you, I'm not looking for this stuff. Oh, wow. I got to backpack. I got to backtrack. Trust me. Remember the meltdown I had in the car up to Six Flags? I said, it's happening now. This is my first introduction to the sign stuff. We're at a hotel in Atlanta. And my little Matthew, I got two boys, Vincent and Matthew. My little Matthew's 2 at the time, 2 and a half. And we're in a hotel, and we asked, look at the place. Oh, there's a pizzeria just over there. So we walk out, we're just walking distance. We walk out the hotel, we're walking down. It's high up, we're walking down a steep driveway. And little Matthew's going, all of a sudden, I'm walking down the river of life. What? And we weren't listening to I Got a River of Life in the car. I wasn't talking about the River of Life. There's nothing to do. All of a sudden, he's going, I'm walking down the River of Life. Well, Matthew, what did you say? And Joy's looking, I'm walking down the River of Life. My 2-year-old, 2 and a half. We go to Mellow Mushroom. This is my first, introduction. And we're sitting down, and all of a sudden, I turn around, I don't know why, I look, and all of a sudden, and this is before my 999 dream, by the way, this is before the dream, it's about 3 years ago, I'm looking at a mural of a man in a canoe in a river. And it goes down, 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 and it's against the wall, it's flat. But then there's an injection or vacuum form plastic mold where it's like 3D coming out of the wall, and it's a river, falls into a waterfall, and he's in the canoe going down the river. Hello? As soon as I'm seeing this, I look at my wife, did you see that? She looks at me. All of a sudden, Mellow Mushroom has got this whole 60s vibe. I don't know if you've ever been there to play 60s music. All of a sudden I hear, it's the sign of the times. The ba, ba, ba. It's the sign of the times. I'm like, what the Dutch? And then I got this impartation from Jones. He's all about like strategic times. He'll just check his watch. So he'll look once in a while. He's a little guilty of that. I look at the clock. 9 o'clock on the dot. That was before the 999 dreams. Nine is fruitfulness. Nine gifts. Nine fruits is the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit and the gift is going to be married in such a way, because no longer, we have been guilty of just the gifts, gifts, gifts. But you know what? Some of the most precious saints that I have met in this camp, they don't know how to prophesy. They can't speak in tongues, but boy, are they humble. Boy, are they filled with peace and love. Boy, will they serve you. I mean, the meekness of Christ. I'm like so touched by these people. And the humility and the tenderness. I just say, God, I that's... Without love, we're clanging, you know, whatever. Just
right.
We're a mess. We're just a big, loud noise. And I used to do a lot of talking in my day. You know, just all about me or my revelation or whatever, just whatever. I don't want to even talk anymore. I just only want to say what I have to say. You know, that's it. I don't need to say. You know, God does not need us. He needs that revelation. He chooses to anoint us because it's his plan, but he don't need us. We need to get over ourselves. We're privileged. We are blessed. But he doesn't need us. He can pull back the curtains at any time and just every knee will just... But he chooses to hide himself because that's how he unfolds his plan. He hides himself. So, okay. So now, Hanson, let me get to the nines and all. That was the end of the 999 stuff. Okay? But there's the partner, there's the other key. It's 1111 and 111. And I've been getting this now from like spring till for about 4 or 5 months, from like April or May till about November or December. And it'll still pop up. In fact, when I started this trip, I put the rental car on and bam, 111. I was like, God, you're doing something. This is cool. It was just cool. All right, so I'm getting all these, and I'm saying, God, you're saying something, but I don't have a clue as what you're saying. I'm not wired like these guys. I need, you're showing me something, but I'm not seeing it. Please speak to me. I've been meeting some of the most precious saints from all over the world through Stephen Jones and his website, selling in Australia, Europe, all over. And they're precious. I mean, I feel so enriched, godly, Holy Ghost, kingdom, loving people. I feel like the richest man on the planet. The body of Christ enriches you. And this guy calls me. I spoke to him once before. He calls me. You ready for this? He's from the UK. He goes, Brother Vinny, I felt led to call you. I said, why? What's going on? What's the Lord saying? He goes, well, I've been getting a lot of 1111s and 111s the last several months. Are you getting the picture now? You're getting why I'm so crazed? Because it's just blowing me away. He doesn't know I'm getting 11s and 1s. He didn't know that. We didn't Skype or do Facebook. I'm just asking God, what does this mean? He's got this brother from the UK getting the same thing. Only he gives me a missing part, which we'll see if it happens, because it hasn't happened yet. And we got more stuff coming. You guys okay? Am I keeping you too long?
No.
All right, good. He goes, well, we have... Oh, this is so much fun. Hey, Robo Shakai. Man, God is fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. We are created for his pleasure. The devil can't do squat. He's just a lying, thieving copycat. He can't copy squat. God is the one, and him is fullness of joy. Fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore, and we are created for those pleasures.
Yes, we are.
God is cool, and God is fun. You want to walk with Jesus? I'll tell you how to walk with Jesus. Take him real serious, but don't take yourself so serious. And just enjoy him. Get over yourself. Ha! Hallelujah forevermore. So anyway, I'm going to go to... Man, this is going to trip. All right, so he goes, we have a prayer group. And we've been praying, and this lady started sharing about Deuteronomy 11:11. Well, it just turned out, most of the time I read Jones's blogs, I missed that. He had written on Deuteronomy 11:11. So he goes, Vinny, go there. I said, okay. So I go there. Deuteronomy 11:11, let's see. But the land, talking about the promised land, which you cross over to possess is a land of hills and valleys which drinks water from the rain of heaven. Okay? It's about a well-watered promised land.
Yes.
That's 11:11.
Yes.
Gets better. This is going to really trip me out. Because this is where I got a little importation now from my friend Ron. Ron does this kind of called it Holy Ghost math. And he kind of sees these symbols and stuff. So I'm getting a little importation with these guys, right? So I go... Then I say to myself, what about 111? He goes, then I'm saying to myself, here's the 999 part, Steve. I said, because the last revelation was 999. So I go to myself, this is what Ron would do. 999 plus 111 is 1,000. I said, no, that's not right. 999 plus 1 is 1,000. But then I broke down 9 plus 1 is 10, 9 plus 1 is 10, 9 plus 1 is 10, and 10 times 10 times 10 is 1,000. By the way, whenever you see the word 1,000, the number 1,000, the millennium, it's all about the glory. Mm-hmm. 1,000 represents the glory. That's why Adam only lived 930 years. 70 represents restoration. Jesus sent out the 70. 930 plus 70 is 1,000. Methuselah, who I'll get into that, only the oldest man to live, 969. 31 years short. It's a typology of no man can inherit the kingdom by the flesh. We cannot enter the glory by the flesh. All these things mean every jot and tittle. I have such a hunger now for the word, it's off the chart. And God is speaking to me every day, throughout the day. It's just blowing me away. The marriage of the male, the manna, and the quail. Here I am thinking, okay, I'm going to give him my part. I had no idea the impartation that I would receive. So now, you ready for this? This gets really good. Oh, yeah. Don't turn there yet. Let me do the punchline. Deuteronomy 1:11. So I said, so 1:11 with the 999 is 1,000. It's the glory. Got that? In my mind. Here we go. Deuteronomy 1:11. Never read this. Didn't know I was going to say this. For the land of you read. Are you there or no?
Yeah.
Deuteronomy 1:11. Hang on.
The Lord God of your fathers make you 1,000 times so many more as ye are and bless you as he hath promised.
There's an exclamation point at the end of that, by the way. Did you guys just catch that? In my mind, I'm doing some Holy Ghost math, not knowing that when I would read Deuteronomy 1:11, the word 1,000 would be right there. Bless, make you 1,000 times more numerous, and bless you as he has promised you. This revelation, folks, is not about me. This is about the body of overcomers. This is about the remnant of grace throughout the world. God is revealing stuff to me, to other men, to these men. It's amazing. It's amazing. All right, so now. So, hallelujah, where do I want to go with this? Okay, let's do this. So now, we're in New Year's. I think it's New Year's Day or the next day. I start the day, you know, I'm kind of conscious. I'm not doing like a long fast. I'm not doing any fast. God's got to really knock me over the head fast. But I do start the day, all right, God, I want to seek your face, right? So I'm seeking the Lord, and here's my prayer to the Lord. Okay? This is just maybe a month or two after this 111 thing. I said, God, I said, everything, and this is how you got to pray. Everything that is not the pure word of the Lord in my life, anything that's of the traditions of men or the traditions of the church or doctrines of devils or strongholds from my past, anything that is not of you, I want it out of my life. Remove falsehood. Remove lies. Remove all this stuff out of my life. And I'm just soaking and meditating this, the cry of my, I'm praying this. I go into the throne room. Ron's got a lot of throne room stuff. It's funny. Talk about the royal flush and all that. There we go. Hallelujah. I just, how many played Bible roulette with you and the Holy Ghost? God, give me a word, right? But I don't even think I do it at this point. I just open up the Bible. Yeah, I didn't do that. I just open up the Bible. See, I didn't exercise my faith. I just opened up the Bible. Here's what I read. Turn right to it. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield to those who put their trust in him. Do not add to his words. How much of the church has been added to his words? We have dug our heels into doctrines of men to save face, to for whatever, keep the offerings going, whatever it is. It's time. It is time to say, everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Amen. Unless it's in your belly, you better not preach it or teach it. I only preach what's in my belly. And if I don't have it, there's a lot of stuff I won't touch. Because I believe James. Teachers are going to have the greater judgment. But if you got it, and you're holding back, you better ask the Lord why. Is it fear? Is it pride? You better ask the Lord why. Hey! Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. Two things I request of you. Deprive me not before I die. Remove falsehood and lies far from me. This is almost the exact prayer verbatim. Right? It gets better. I'm just wondering. Give me neither poverty nor riches, nor riches. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Let's let some of the Word of Faith camp confess that. Feed me with the food allotted to me. Well, the King James says only the portion that you have for me. See, that's true prosperity. You have a destiny, you have a calling, and God's going to give you provision for the vision, more than enough for yourself and to share. That is prosperity. I don't want anything that's not for me. I'm not looking for another man's anointing, another man's call. No. I like my life. And to be honest, the older I get and the more kids I have, I like it real simple. Yeah. Gone are the days of, I'm going to do these big crusades and I'm this big church and I'm blah, 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 blah. No, God can still do that, but you know what? If he does do that, it's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be real easy because I enjoy my life. If I'm not enjoying it, I'm basically out. Now, I don't mean that in a bad way, okay? When you're talking to someone that's been through a lot of fire. What I know, what I'm saying is when the joy of the Lord lifts, when the grace lifts, you better know. Because no matter what you go through, there is grace and joy in every situation.
That's right, brother.
Every situation. So when God said, in everything give thanks, he showed me why. Because all things work together for good. In everything give thanks. Why? Because from me and through me and to me are all things. That's why you give thanks in everything. It's all me. See, we've been fighting the devil too long. You see, as a businessman, I learned a long time ago, I learned this from my father, I don't deal with middle management.
Amen.
Now, when you're an owner of a company, you don't like talking to middle management. You want to go to the CEO.
Amen.
He's the head of all principality and power.
Amen.
Some of us have been looking at demons and binding this and binding. You can't bind your circumstances. You can't rebuke them. They're set up with God. Now, do I cast out devils? Absolutely. But I'm not looking for it. I just deal with Jesus. When he says, cast them out, I cast them out. But most of our stuff is God. And see, and we don't have the whole picture. This is why we get offended, Brother Steve. This is why we get offended. Because God is good, the devil is bad, blah, blah, blah. Like, please, give me some more meat. That never sat right with me. In fact, I remember being in Bible school. They were teaching that. I see the way I look at it, the way I see it, because I got the Italian background too. God's like the Don on the throne. You know, he don't pull the trigger, he just kind of gives the orders, or sometimes he just kind of looks away. But make no mistake, he's in control. Have you considered my servant Caleb? Have you considered my servant the Carell family or the Stride family? Have you considered who's in charge? Who's in charge here? He's in charge. And until we have that revelation that he's in charge, we're going to just enjoy what we have. We're not going to get the greater glory. And you know what? It's okay, because only God can give it to you anyway. So it's all good. It's all good. You're right where you need to be at the appointed time. It's all good. Everybody say it's all good. Okay, so. Man, I'm just blowing through water. Alright, so now I close the book. I'm still in the bowl. Oh, John, sorry. Sorry, guys. Alright, so now something rises up in my heart. I just got the word of the Lord. I just read it to you, right? God confirmed the prayer. I mean, verbatim. And I put the book down on the vanity. Now the spirit of faith rises up. You know, all of a sudden it's like this violent, tenacious, the gift of faith. I grab the Bible now. I said, God, I want the word of the Lord. But see, that wasn't me. I take the Bible. It's like almost like I just wanted, like I was just as violent thing came over me. I open the Bible and I just, bam. And Brother Mike, you're going to love this. I fall right to sign number 9. Elisha feeds the 100 men. Brother Stephen has been saying and blogging, it was a prophetic word about all these signs that were coming forth in the earth, and the signs of Elisha. Now these are like prophetic types type of thing, okay? But the 9th sign is the revaluation of the dinar. Okay? And why we believe that is that the dinar in the Greek is denarius. Okay? And why we believe the multiplication of bread, the 9th sign when Elisha multiplies the bread is a type and a shadow of Jesus multiplying the loaves and the fishes. Okay? Right? It's a precursor.
Right.
Precursor. It's a better word. And so in the Greek, it's denarius. One of the disciples said 200 pennies worth. 200 denarius is not enough, but then it becomes multiplied. So I go, God, I want the word of the Lord. I open up the Bible. Elisha feeds 100 men. The sign that we've been believing for 3 years. And there it is. Now, has it revalued yet? No. Will it revalue? I believe it will. I'm not going to say, thus saith the Lord. If it doesn't revalue, is that still God? Yes. Yes. Because at the very least, he is showing the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Okay? But actually, do your homework. That word good was put in there afterwards by the translators. It says the steps of a man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. The steps of a man are ordered by the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. There's something else I wanted to share. About to wrap it up. There's a few more things. Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, so now, understand this. I want to go back to the 999 steps. Okay? That mountain, these were when I clicked on that, there were these exotic staircases all over the world. And one of them, the 999 steps to heaven, was in China. Now, if you've been reading Jones's blogs, there's these two main factions in the world that CNN and MSN and, I mean, you know, Fox News are to talk about. You got the Rothschilds, you got the Rockefellers, you got the Bush Cheney cabal, you got the elitists in the West that have held the world hostage with this fiat money and mystery Babylon. But then, in the East, You have this family called the Dragon family, and they are probably much more rich than these other guys. Only they want to use their gold, that they're sitting on tens of not hundreds of trillions of dollars in wealth. And America robbed them. I'm not going to get into the whole thing. It's really out there. You can go do your homework. It's out there. But here's the point. The sign was a confirmation that Jones has been seeing right, because when him and Ron and I talk, he'll blog, Ron will say something, I'm getting a supernatural piece to what they're saying. And so in this, the fact that the mountain was in China was and the fact that it had tied to Mystery Babylon is that they're seeing and hearing correctly. Well, I didn't tell you, when he started blogging on this, a Christian UN delegate that is a liaison between this ultra-rich family that is in the direct line of the ancestors of the Zheng Qing dynasty, whatever it is. I'm talking, they're behind the scenes in Asia, just like the Rockefellers and Rothschilds are behind the scenes in the West, only the kings of the East. He started blogging about the kings of the East overthrowing Mystery Babylon. I believe it's in Revelation 12, if I'm correct. You can find it. He started blogging on this 3 years ago, interpreting the word, seeing cycles and patterns in the word, the way God wired him. And this guy emails him. He goes, how do you know this stuff? He goes, well, I'm just writing what I see in the word. He goes, well, let me tell you something. You're writing correctly. And we are on the verge of the greatest transfer of wealth. We are on the very precipice of the greatest move of the Spirit this world has ever seen. Ever. But I want to end with this word and maybe one with testimony. The word for promised land is Canaan. Canaan, right? In the Old Testament, it was actual land, inhabited with giants. God said, go take it. Okay? In the New Testament, it's our glorified body, so that we can have the fullness. See, the whole earth, all of creation, not the earth, all of creation is groaning in travail, waiting for the manifestation, the unveiling of the sons of God. Well, we're not going to manifest completely until we're in our glorified body. But I'm telling you, we're really close. So the word Canaan, the root word for Canaan is Cana, I'm not a Hebrew scholar, Kanaw. You know what it means? It means humiliated. Humiliated. You've been crying out for the glory, brother. You and I both know. We've had our share. Brother Larry knows. Brother Landon. Some of you saints know. We've had our share of humiliation. Because we've cried out for the very best. We want the glory of God. Humiliated. A primitive root, properly to bend the knee. Hence to humiliate, vanquish, bring down low, into subjection, into subjection under, humble, subdue. God is going to give us, in His plan, the revelation that He's in complete and absolute control. We will no longer boast in our study, in our confession, and are pressing in. We will no longer boast about how long I fasted. There's a move of God out in the Midwest and I can't stomach it. I fasted for 20 days. I fasted for 30. I fasted for 40. Well, who are you glorifying? Where is God getting the glory? And I did this. We better be careful. We better be careful. Now, I want you guys to stand up and I want to pray for some folks because I'm about to explode out of my skin. And I'm going to pray. You guys move this week, Brother Steve. I'm going to share one other quick testimony. Okay? This is a crazy answered prayer. And I'm going to pray for folks. If you guys play, just keep it real, real soft. Don't worry about it. Okay. Back in late May, June, springtime, late spring. My kids were begging me for a dog. And I was like, God, I got 7 kids. I mean, I grew up with boxers. I mean, Rascal. Remember, I don't know if you guys seen Rascal. Beautiful boxer. Love that dog. Oh, I had 4 different boxers in my childhood. I love boxers. I mean, there's like people in dog suits. They're just awesome. And then they're strong, but they're tender, and they're loving, and they're great with kids, but they look mean. Kind of like me. And I just love that dog. I told my kids, specifically, I don't know if you were there. I think I told Natalie, I think I told Danielle and Georgia. Were you there?
I remember.
I told my kids, just real flippantly, no great faith, just kind of off the cuff. Well, guys, I tell you what, you get your faith out there, and you ask God, if God would somehow send me a boxer, I'll consider it. Because I already knew these kids are going to be praying hard, and I knew if a boxer showed up at my front door, as much as I love him, I still didn't know I was ready for a dog. So I even hedged my bet. I didn't say I'd do it. I said, if God would somehow give me a boxer, I'll consider it. Well, do you know, about a month later, I took my daughter, Natalie, with a beautiful voice, who she will sing tomorrow in Jesus' name. She was part of this kind of really elite, really cool choir in Pensacola, the Pensacola Children's Chorus. And they do like the Sanger Theater. It's like a Broadway production. Unbelievable. It's little kids. It's the bomb. So I drop her off the dress rehearsal. I come around the corner, and there's this gorgeous brindle boxer in the middle of the street. You guys catching this?
Yeah.
I'm on one side, he's on the other. I immediately pull over. He had no collar on. I come up to him and say, come on, buddy, come here. He runs in my car, gets in, he's licking my face, he's wagging his tail, he's going crazy, right? I take him home, the kids are flipped out. They're like, oh my goodness, God answers prayer. This is a trick. Can you imagine? You understand, boxers are pretty rare dogs. You don't see a lot of boxers around. And they're not cheap. They're about $1,500 to $2,000 for a really good-looking box. And I'm like, this is so tripped out. I mean, this is what I'm talking about. Just answered prayer and revelation, and it's been nuts. So wait. So he was beautiful. He didn't have a collar on, but I knew he had to have an owner. So I said, all right, guys, I was tempted to just keep him because he didn't have a collar. I could, like, technically get away with it. But I knew in my spirit that wouldn't be right, just to just take him. So we bought him food, we bought him bones, we just were loving our dog. He's just this dog's going crazy. Kids are going crazy. Everybody's going crazy. So the next day, I take Natalie back to practice, and I say, you know what, I got to look. Someone's got a poster up here somewhere. I got to look for a poster. Sure enough, almost the exact spot where I stopped, there's these really nice condos in downtown Pensacola, and there's a picture of the dog. I'm not going to tell you his name yet because that's part of his journey. It's crazy. I wait till real late that night because I want to keep him one more night, but I want the guy to go to bed in peace, so I don't want to be too cruel. So I call about 10 o'clock at night. We got your dog. Oh, thank you so much. You're such a prince. Oh, blah, blah, blah. Okay. We see the next day. And then he goes, maybe sometime I'll bring the dog and they can play with the kids. And then he's supposed to come next week. He didn't come. He came like 3 weeks later. And actually, Stephen Jones was at the house when he came. It was kind of funny. He came to do some teaching, and my parents were in town. We're barbecuing, the pool, the dogs running around everywhere. We're going crazy, right? So then he tells me, you know, I'm about to go to Vegas. So I got a job. I said, really? I said, well, what are you going to do with the dog? He goes, well, to be honest, that's why I came. I was hoping you'd take him. Now, you gotta understand something. Wherever I take this dog, he is a walking sign of wonder. He's a gorgeous boxer. He is a showpiece. And people ask me, oh, blah, blah, blah. You know what I do? Let me tell you the story. Let me tell you my testimony. Now, you talk about just keep it low, guys. Specific answered prayer, super quick. I believe the body is going to step into that now. Brother Landon, I'm telling you, just the fact that I'm here sharing this is an impartation. There's going to be, when I lay hands on you, there's going to be impartation for whatever God wants to do. It's all God. But if you need physical healing, we're going to believe for it. If you need emotional healing, we're going to believe for it. But I believe the main thing, because I share this, is going to be an awakening that your steps are ordered of the Lord. I don't care how much hell you've been through. Your steps are ordered of the Lord. I'm telling you, when you catch this, you could be in a Quonset hut with nothing to eat and you will be laughing in the spirit because you know God's got you there. That is the revelation.
Yeah.
That is the revelation. Now let me share this part. I called my friend Ron, and this will be the last testimony, because I want to lay hands on folks. I immediately know that this is not just an answered prayer for a dog. This is a prophetic sign. This ties in, Brother Steve, with all this other stuff. And here it goes. So I called my friend Ron. I said, Ron, I told him the story. God answered prayer. He gave us a dog. It's a boxer. I said, I know there's a prophetic revelation here. Immediately says the Boxer Rebellion. I'm like, the Boxer Rebellion? I don't even know what that is. That was happening in the early 1900s in China when they were killing all the missionaries and the Japanese, and they were cleaning house. It was a violent time. He goes, but God's reversing the curse. I said, okay. Now, yeah, my knee-jerk reaction is this guy's out to lunch. Okay, in my pride, because I don't have any paradigm for this. But somehow, some way, I'm like, God, just like, let me hear him out. Okay? So he goes, what street was he found on? No. He goes, what's his name? I said, his name is Rocky. I said, well, to be honest, that was a funny thing, because my brother had a boxer named Rocky, and he just died, and I wanted to take the name Rocky, and it was kind of like a little strike there. Then he said, you can call him Rocky. So he goes, oh, so he's Rocky too. Okay, yeah. Well, Rocky 2, if you remember the movie, that's when he defeats Apollo Creed, who represents the sun god. Mystery Babylon is coming down. Yeah. What have you talking about? 999, Mystery Babylon coming down. God answered a prayer. This is the interpretation. It gets better. Wait. He goes, what street was he found on? I'm like, wait, where is this guy smoking? And then I go, oh my goodness. Jefferson Street. For the last couple of years, all they've been talking about is Thomas Jefferson used for the Louisiana Purchase, the double portion, it's the Joseph Company. Judah is the head, Joseph, and Joshua is the body. Judah had the dominion mandate, Jesus. The body has the fruitfulness mandate. Study Genesis. And we're coming, and the repair of the breach is coming. The head and the body are coming together. With divine fruitfulness and wealth, and power and love, just like the dream, to bring the kingdom of God into full manifestation on the earth. This is where we are at, people. So wait, not only that, then it dawns on me, wait a second, it could mean Jefferson Davis. He was the leader of the rebels. And God has reversed the curse. But you ready for this? Here's the punchline. Every time I want to say this guy is out to lunch, every time I'm tempted to say this is too nuts, God gives me a supernatural sign and a wonder. And then just like the suits, the security box and the 999s, then it dawned on me, oh my goodness. Ron, we changed his name. You said the Boxer Rebellion. His name was Rebel. And we changed it to Rock. Now, you have a lot to digest this week. You've been stretched beyond. I'm sure of that. How many would agree you've been stretched? But I pray, and I'm going to pray this blanket prayer right now. Just raise your hands. I release now. I'm going to pray for you, lay hands on you. But right now, I release an impartation of revelation that your steps are divinely, supernaturally ordered of the Lord. That you have not missed. I want to share one more testimony. Put your hands down. God just quickened me. I shared the 999 trip and the revelation of sovereignty God. I shouldn't have said that. Anyway, don't tell anybody. I'm supposed to say it for somebody I know. I share this. I'm just talking. I'm not trying to release an impartation. I'm just sharing. All of a sudden on the other phone I hear, she is screaming in tongues. This is not normal. She's shrieking and crying hysterically. The fire of God is coming on her, and she is completely set free. The body of Christ has been too much. Did I confess enough? Should I marry that one? Why is this so hard? The devil's on my back. Regrets, 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 regrets. I'm here to tell you that your steps have been divinely ordered of the Lord. And that is the word of the hour. She had regrets about everything. But when I released that testimony, the Spirit of God backed it up with a sign and a wonder. She got instantly free. That's the power of speaking the whole word. So come on up. I want to lay hands, but don't know yet. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray impartation of revelation of your sovereign grace that you were predestined before the foundation of the world to be his son, to be his daughter, that the riches of the glory of his grace would be manifest in the ages to come. Father, I speak a revelation as they walk, as they watch TV, as they read a paper, as they're driving. Boom, 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 boom. Oh my goodness, I never saw that. Boom, 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 boom. Oh my goodness, I never saw that. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness, oh my goodness. What a God. What a God. What a God. What a God. Now that's that impartation. Now I want to give you some of the fun stuff. If you need joy, if you need healing, if you need restoration in your heart, you've been hurt, you've been wounded, you've been bitter, whatever it is, you've been backslidden. The Bible says now is the appointed time. Here's the balance. Come up and repent. Come up and receive Jesus. Come up and receive healing. Come up and receive some joy. Come up and receive a fresh filling. Come on, that's the invitation. Let's go. Hallelujah.